Good evening. Hi, everyone. Just a few announcements. If you need to use the restroom, it's through into the library on the right-hand side as you go in. When we have our question and answer period, which I don't know what time, probably around 7:15, maybe 7:20, the microphone will be at the mic stand. The meeting is being recorded for a podcast, so please try to use the mic if you have a question. For those of us at the front of the room, if you're not speaking into the mic, shut off the mic when you're not using it. And yes, please silence your cell phones. And without further ado, I'll turn it over to Rusko Kayangyang.
Thank you, Nathan. Well, good evening. Thanks for coming out here tonight. Welcome to tonight's presentation, How Richmond Triumph, a local community defining its own destiny. Tonight's speakers are Richmond's current city council members, Jovanka Beckles, and Gail McLaughlin, also former mayor. And just a note, Gail used to live in Vallejo while back. Yes. Tonight we are here to learn from our neighbors in Richmond. To do so, we must ask ourselves, what are the obstacles here in Vallejo which prevent progressive change? How can we as citizens work together to create a progressive alliance that will be able to overcome the obstacles in our path? When we listen to how Richmond's Progressive Alliance, RPA, brought about change, ask yourself, can we do similar work here in Vallejo? Without further ado, I'd like to turn it over to two of our colleagues, Gail and Jovanka.
So I have a PowerPoint, so maybe we should just, I'll run through the PowerPoint first, and then if Jovanka wants to add anything, and then Q&A, I'm sure we'll all have a lot to exchange information about. So this PowerPoint, well, first of all, thank you all for inviting me. Thank you, Rusko. Thank you, Nathan. Thank you, everyone. It's a privilege to be here with the grassroots trying to make change. That's what we're all about. So. So this PowerPoint is defined as Richmond, California, a local community defining its own destiny. So we have a beautifully diverse community in Richmond. We have a population of 108,000, which is probably similar to Vallejo's numbers, I don't know. Under poverty, we have actually a little bit more than 18%, about 18.5%. We have 40% Latino members of our community, 27% African American, 17% white, 13% Asian. So you can see we are a majority people of color community. We're vibrant, we are a wonderfully diverse community. That's our strength. Next. And here is an example of our vibrant community in action. This is Juneteenth on the left there, our celebration at Nickel Park, and here's some young people dancing in the Cinco de Mayo parade on 23rd Street. Next. So, in recent years, Richmond has become known for our progressive politics. Over the last decade, we've worked hard and gotten that reputation. And we've had candidate victories, and that's part of the reason that we have been able to make such progressive change. I won my council race in 2004, then I ran for mayor in 2006 and won that. Then we had Jeff Ritterman running and winning his race for city council in 2008. Then in 2010, I was reelected as mayor, and Jovanka Beckles won her city council seat. And then our latest victory was this past 2014 election, where myself, Jovanka, and Eduardo Martinez won our city council seats as Team Richmond, we called ourselves. It was a clean sweep victory, so we were very proud. A lot of hard work and had to go up against some big money, $3 million worth of Chevron money thrown to try and defeat us. Next. Another victory we had is a citizens' ballot measure in 2008 that was passed by the Richmond voters. It would have taxed large manufacturers, predominantly Chevron. The measure, sadly, was overturned by the courts. There was some language that they felt was not legal. But we immediately started working on a new ballot measure requiring Chevron to pay its fair share of utility taxes. So this action, this constant grassroots action, and knowing that the voters were on our side, brought Chevron to the negotiating table, and we forced a $114 million settlement to the city. So how did we get these victories, and in what context? Next. So we were known as a company town. We're home to the 112, maybe it's 113. Go back, Paul. We are home to the Chevron oil refinery, and that's the Chevron Richmond Oil Refinery is California's single largest greenhouse gas polluter. The refinery impacts our community and our environment with toxic air contaminants and criteria air pollutants daily. It also doesn't pay its fair share of taxes. We got that settlement, which was a plus. Still doesn't pay its fair share. It doesn't hire locally. Only about 5 to 7% of the employees are Richmond residents. Next. And it's a constant risk to workers and communities, such as the 2012 fire. You may have heard about this. A toxic plume spread across Richmond all the way to San Francisco, actually. And 15,000 people had to go to local hospitals for treatment for respiratory ailments. So that stuff is dangerous. And there was a history of corruption and crime in Richmond for decades. Richmond was known for its corruption, crime, and Chevron, the three C's. And Chevron, of course, polluted, but they also dominated City Hall, and they had elected officials in their pockets. And they had this up until recently. They had a lot of council members in their pocket. Here's a little cartoon there, marching to the beat of Chevron's drum, some of the candidates and elected officials. Next. So, how did we deal with all this? Well, in 2003, the Richmond Progressive Alliance emerged. And what we realized in 2003 was that all the groups doing grassroots progressive advocacy in Richmond, like I'm sure you have in Vallejo, but they needed to have their people, our people, on the city council making the decisions. People were tired of urging, begging, protesting, demonstrating without getting results. So we needed people sitting in those seats who stood for the grassroots of our city. Another thing that was happening, this is as the RPA was getting itself going. The city of Richmond lost $35 million and never even looked for it or demanded a criminal investigation. The city council at that time laid off police and firefighters, closed youth programs and services. So this $35 million financial debacle and the cuts that resulted caused much suffering, including increased levels of violence. Money going right out the money, nobody knows where it went. So the RPA brought organizations together. We became the glue tying together other groups, such as SEIU 790, now SEIU 1021. They had experienced the bulk of the layoffs. West County Toxics Coalition was fighting pollution. We had a day laborers movement, we still do in Richmond, people just wanting to get paid for a hard day's work. We had police accountability groups fighting police brutality. We had homelessness is not a crime advocates. We had open shoreline and open space advocates, industrial toxic cleanup activists, rent control and just cause for eviction advocates. We pulled people together as part of our movement. Next. We had a people's convention in 2004. We mobilized all these groups and individuals together, and we did it for a few reasons. One, to mobilize the grassroots. Two, to educate about a different way of doing politics with ethics, you know, a novel idea. We showed a united front. We got press. We were supporting the people's priorities. And we showcased candidates who stood only for the people and took no corporate donations. Next. And so we grew our movement. After decades of Chevron domination, ordinary people in Richmond were organizing together and standing up for their own interests. Here's one of the many marches we've had in Richmond. Next. So our basic electoral strategy is this. We have hundreds of volunteers participating in different aspects of our local campaigns, starting early every election year. You know, we'll be starting early next year for the 2016 elections. Because our candidates do not take corporate money, and all of us are PA elected officials, one without a penny of corporate money, but it's because we started early and we spend our money wisely and creatively. There's one of our Team Richmond banners, Chevron equals money power, Team Richmond equals our power. So we make that message known, you know, vote for those who stand with the people. Next. So mobilize, 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 and get the word out. Educate voters going door to door. We always educate them about Chevron and other corporate motives and about, you know, Richmond's challenges and its possibilities, having a vision for a better city. Hold house parties, do social media. We put out our own RPAE newsletter, and we have a hard copy newsletter called The Richmond Sun. So we've been doing this for about 10 years. We've got some good materials. Next. And so there's like a three-legged table to our model, and it's grassroots mobilization, coalition building, groups coming together, and running candidates that cannot be bought off. Together we fight back. Next. And not just in election years. It has to happen all the time. Next. So here's an example of us connecting movements in non-election years, and we promote these movements in the election year with the candidates who stand for them. There's standing up to Wall Street. Here's we voted no on a casino. There was an advisory ballot measure. Some of us had been fighting that for a long time. Finally, it's out of the picture. I heard you stopped a casino too. Great, good work. Richmond IDs, we have IDs for everybody in Richmond, even those with immigration status or just coming out of prison or homeless. We think that's important. Civic pride, also great to everybody has a right to have city services, bank services. Here's our solar movement, our green job movement. We're big on solar in Richmond, people coming together talking about green jobs. Here is how we address the roots of our crime. We do it like with everything else, with movement building. We stopped a new prison from being built. Now we have another prison that is, or another expansion that they're trying to build that, again, we're mobilizing to try and stop. But this was a project, a proposed jail back a few years back. I don't remember when it was. Invest in people, not in prisons. We wanted the money coming from the state for re-entry programs to really give people a chance to make it. You know, they come out of prison, they don't have a chance. So people organized, you can see. We also had a protest, and we're very strong on the Black Lives Matter. Jovanka has been a really, really strong leader on that. Here's Jovanka and myself and our police chief standing on a protest saying Black Lives Matter. We stand together in Richmond. We have a community-involved police force. So the people's work gets results. Let's see some more examples. Here's our homicide rate going down. In the 90s, we had 61 homicides. I mean, that is just heartbreaking. Actually, this chart only goes up to 2013. In 2014, we got down to 11 homicides. Still 11 too many. But you can see that we have really made great progress. And it's because we address the roots of our violence. We give opportunities for our youth. We have a community-involved police force, et cetera, et cetera. Next. In 2014, we increased our minimum wage. We have a phased-in approach where it'll be going up to $13 an hour. Right now, it's going up to something like $10 an hour, then $11, then it'll go up to $12, and then $13. It goes up quicker in the next, but in the next 3 years, it'll be up to $13. As you can see, the cost of living goes up, fuel goes up, tuition goes up, price of milk goes up, but the guy with the magnifying glass is looking at the minimum wage, and he can't quite find it. It's not going up. It's stuck there. So, we know that's a big, important issue, so we got some changes on that. We do worker-owned co-ops. We know that workplace democracy is very important, so that this is a group called Fusion Latina. It's a catering service. They own it together. They make decisions together. They share the profits together, so we promote this as a really important form of business development. Next. So staying the course leads to more and more victories. And against all odds, we win. In 2014, with Chevron spending over $3 million to try and elect a pro-oil, anti-environment candidates, we, and this is Team Richmond, spent less than $200,000 for all three of our candidates, me, Jovanka, and Eduardo. We spent about $60,000+ each. That's less than $200,000, while Chevron spent $3 million to try and defeat us. So we were outspent about 20-1, and we still won. It's because we really work hard and we really educate people. And our local struggles have reached national attention. And, you know, this, like I said, has been a decade of work. Richmond's defiance towards Chevron and other corporations, including big banks, we've had a strong movement standing up to Wall Street, has generated attention in the New York Times, PBS, The Nation, Bill Moyers, Rachel Maddow. They say, how do they do it? You know, because, you know, it's such a big corporate domination that we've managed to come out from under. So in conclusion, RPA, the Richmond Progressive Alliance, it's a new successful progressive game. Every city has lots of advocacy groups urging, sometimes begging for change in their area of concern. Don't beg. Come together. Elect people who represent you and who will not sell out, who will stand with you. And you have a new and successful progressive game. Be at the table. That's what the RPA did. Next, the very last slide. You can do it too. We showed that a better Richmond was possible and a better Vallejo is possible too. So no progress without struggle. So thank you. So I'm gonna do questions. So, Jovanka, you want to add a few points?
I can't think of anything else to add to this. I mean, it was, you know, very well said and documented, and I think that maybe as folks ask questions, and I'm reminded because I did see some slides that I was going to add, you know, I can't remember them now, so if you all, you know, as you ask your questions, I'm sure it'll come back.
So I'm going to put this microphone on the mic stand, and if you have questions, come up to the mic and ask your questions.
Looking around the room, I don't see very many young people. Were you able to engage young people into your causes, and how did you do it?
Well, I'll start. I'm sure, you know, Gail, I'm sure you can, you know, add to this. But we were able to, you know, to have young people. You know, I think that the young people, I think, all over our nation are waking up, you know, because they're really seeing their opportunities dwindle. It's just dwindling more and more and more. And so what energized the young people in Richmond was, for the first time, I believe for the first time ever, they saw candidates in their city that said, we're not taking any money from any corporations or developers. Like, I don't think they ever heard that. And the fact that, you know, we said that, we meant it, they were able to see that, okay, well, you know, maybe these are people we can trust. Because, you know, young people have come to the point where they feel like, you know, you're running for office or already in office, you're a politician who is just kind of trying to figure out which way the wind is blowing, and you really don't care about them. But in Richmond, they really saw that by us making that pledge, that they could believe that we really were going to be about the people. We were not politicians. We weren't going to be politicians. We were there representing them. We will be their elected officials, and we would be their representative. And that really, you know, said said a lot, and it really resonated with the young folks. So it brought them out. It really did. Did you want to add something?
That's very true. You know, I think our message resonates with the young people, and we make space for them because we know, you know, they're the ones who are going to continue the torch, you know, carrying the torch as you know, we get older and older and can't do so. But we are in the process of reorganizing in the RPA, and one thing we want to do is bring in even more young people. So we do have some RPA steering committee members that are young, and they're very eager to bring in some of their friends and colleagues. So we think we'll even have more as time goes on.
And then, you know, to add to that, I think that even like right now, there may not be a lot of young folks in the RPA organization itself. But you look at those that are, that belong to other organizations. One example I can think of is ACE, the Alliance of Californians for Community Empowerment, used to be ACORN. A lot of folks that are in that organization, at least the ones doing a lot of the organizing, they're young people. And so they are part of the alliance that, you know, Gail mentioned earlier. So they may not have, you know, membership in the RPA, but they're our allies, and they are working hard towards the change. Mm-hmm. You have a question? You wanna?
Yeah, thanks. So I noticed that a lot of the organizations that you brought together were grassroots organizations, and we all know that grassroots organizations struggle to survive, you know, have like scarcity mentality and never enough money to do anything. So my question is, how did you move them from competing to collaboration? How did you get folks from looking at each other as competitors and get to the point where they were collaborators?
So it's been an ongoing struggle and an ongoing evolution, if you will. And what Jovanka mentioned about our allies, we're still in the process of this evolutionary world. In our new RPA steering committee, which has yet to be elected and will be by the larger membership, we will have seats for our allies. So they will be decision makers of the RPA. And I think, you know, we were just there. You know, we got involved when ACE has a struggle or an issue, we talk about it, we stand for it. If it's social equity, if it's, you know, environmental health, if it's sustainability issues, you know, we have, I think we just made sure that we were there for them, and that their numbers and their organizing helped advance the progressive cause in our city. Yeah, nonprofits, when they're nonprofits, there's always a scarcity of funding, and you know, the best we can do is, you know, encourage them to apply for grants and stand for them and all that. We as an organization can't help because we're just hanging on there ourselves. As when I was mayor, I could, you know, point them to various grant proposals and, you know, foundations and such. And I think we still do that. So, but we find that people are coming together, and it's an evolutionary process.
You know, and to add a little to that, one of the challenges was, you know, because of their status as, you know, nonprofits, many of the folks were actually initially a little, you know, afraid, a little nervous about participating, and because, you know, there's not a lot of grants, and so being afraid of losing those grants by participating too much in political activities. But one of the things that we help them to understand is they can do whatever they want to when they're not on the clock. You know, whatever, that's your job. So if this is your job as this and that's nonprofit, when you get off, you get to do whatever you want to. And so if you live in this city and you're off work, you can go and help make your city better. And but that had to be, you know, we had to say that a lot before folks started getting a little more relaxed about doing it. But that's, you know, to me, like that spoke volumes about some of the challenges that, you know, we were dealing with. You know, here you are, nonprofits who want to do good work, but then they're afraid, you know, of losing those monies. You know, this in this grassroots movement building that went on in Richmond, folks saw that, okay, you know what, I want to change, but I also know that if I'm working for housing, around housing, or if I'm working for with the formerly incarcerated, we have a group called the, you know, Safe Return Project. Should I sort of be paralyzed and not help bring about this change, or can I still help? Because what happens is, if I'm working with the formerly incarcerated and I have policies that I know needs to be enacted, need to be you know, brought forward, how is that going to happen if I don't do my part? And so, like with the Safe Return Project, you know, they have a lot of the formerly incarcerated have a lot of issues when they re-enter into the community, housing, employment, you know, that box that says, you know, have you ever been, you know, right? And so they realize that, oh, you know, if we have people on this city government that could care less about our issues, then all that work we're doing is in vain. So that really helped bring them into, you know, the movement.
Thank you. In my reading, I learned that Richmond had a very innovative program to intervene with citizens who are most likely to commit murder or to be killed, and that the city has devoted resources and created a, for lack of a better word, a mentor program to aggressively intervene and to offer these people educational opportunities, counseling, nurturance, and support. I also understand that the program operates independently of the police department, with access to perhaps statistical and information in such a way that they can identify these people, and that you have created a coalition of, or an organization which administers it, which is comprised of members of the community, which, so they have street cred, so they can actually go out and say, look, our government, our society, acknowledges that you're in a desperate state, and we'd like to lift you out of this. And this is what I understand to be one of the reasons that your crime rate has dropped. I live in the downtown here, and each month we hear gunshots. I think it's about this last month it was 3 or 4 incidents. And could you talk about this program and amplify it and correct anything I said incorrectly, because I think our citizens, or I think our town would benefit from this type of direct intervention in order to improve the lives of our citizens. Thank you.
Gail, would you like this? Because you were on the council when it started, and so maybe Gail can give a little background and then I'll interject.
Sure.
Yes, you're talking about the Office of Neighborhood Safety. So actually, that was a program that I put the proposal forward for in 20, I don't remember exactly when it was, maybe it was 2007. And it's a program that, first thing we did was hire a director, then we hired neighborhood change agents. And these were people that were formerly incarcerated themselves who had the street cred, and the idea is for them to be outreach teams going into the neighborhoods to quell the violence before it starts, you know, to really provide them with mentoring, to provide with opportunities for substance abuse programs, whatever, you know, whatever, conflict mediation. And so it took off and it was very successful, but they actually have a new arm of the Office of Neighborhood Safety over the last few years, and that is the Peace Fellowship. And some of the most, those who individuals who have caused the most problems, the most difficult individuals in terms of shooters, et cetera, they were given an opportunity to be a part of this program where day in and day out they would have mentoring, they'd have workshops, they'd have programs, and they had to come every day and participate in their program. And if so, they would get a $1,000 stipend a month. So this was controversial, you know, why giving people money? But this has worked. And it has gotten a lot of press all over the nation that the Peace Fellowship, something like 99% of the young men in this program have stayed in the program, have not recommitted crimes, and you know there has been something like a 70% recidivism rate in our county. So they have not recommitted crimes, and so but they have to stay in their program. So that's ONS. We have other programs as well. Do you want to talk about maybe ceasefire?
So in addition to the Office of Neighborhood Safety, then we also have a ceasefire, and that's faith-based. And so with the basically the different churches in the city collaborate, and what they do, because this is all a part of, you know, how are we going to reduce gun violence in our city? So there's ONS, and then the ceasefire, and every Friday night, 7 o'clock, members from these congregations come and walk around the city and have signs that say, you know, we love you, we want you to be alive, you know, we want you at peace, and you know they have their chants. But what people see, you know, it makes you think, because you know you're a kid in a neighborhood that's prone to violence, and you see folks coming around saying, "We love you. We want you to stay alive. We don't want you in jail. There is another way of living," and that's been something that's also been effective. So these walks, which since it's faith-based, you know, there's prayer. So for those you know who believe in prayer, there's people are praying specifically, you know, for healing and peace, and that's another aspect of you know how we bring back. So that's the multifaceted, holistic approach that we've been using in Richmond. Is there another one? So the NOS, ceasefire,
safe return, of course, that we already talked about.
Right. And I really feel like you know hope makes such a big difference. I was talking to a friend of mine today, a Palestinian friend of mine, and he was talking about just, we had a long conversation, but the end of it, he said, you know, when people think that, you know, these young people just want to blow up things just for the sake of it, he goes, they've lost hope. They've seen their families, their homes, you know, blow. They figure, what do I have to lose? They have no hope. And so what we've, I think, done a really good job of doing is really trying to instill hope back into our community, because it really makes a big difference.
So I think the approach, just because this is an important topic, I just want to tie it all up. The approach is to address the roots of the violence. You know, it means giving opportunity, but it means telling them, hey, if you don't do the ceasefire program, if you don't do it and accept the help we have to offer, the programs, et cetera, the police are going to be watching you and you're going to end up in prison or worse yet, dead. So but we address the roots. We provide the jobs. We have a great job program, green job program. We provide the youth activities. We seek out the grant funding, the stipend program for ONS. It's all grant funded. The city doesn't have money. You know, you have to seek out the grant funds. So, you know, our advocation for the hope, for the stopping the violence at its roots is what caused the city staff to seek out the grants and to make the changes that we wanted.
And to elaborate a little bit more about, as you know, we said hope, is that so now when you have a council that's filled with folks who are elected for you, for the people, then you can create policies that give hope to the community. One of those policies was the ban the box. So, you know, the Safe Return Project said, look, people are coming back and they don't feel like, what's the point? What's the point of doing good when there's no job? Nobody's gonna hire me. As soon as I check that box, it's over, right? So you create hope. So the hope is, okay, we're gonna create a policy that says that the city will take that box off of our applications. That created so much hope. You know, so we're talking about the kinds of policies that bring about hope for people, raising the minimum wage, but having, you know, electeds that are, you know, sharing that, what's the word I'm looking for? Those views or, you know, perspective, right?
My name is Robert Padilla. I've been living in Vallejo since 81. I lived in Richmond from 77 to 79, and I met you through my friend Eduardo about 10 years ago at a meeting at the library. Nice, wonderful to have you all here tonight. I just wanted to make a comment. I was a member, well, actually I'm still a member of two of the civic organizations in West Contra Costa County, and a couple of times I've heard other members of the board say nice things about Chevron. And one of the things that I said when I heard that kind of wonderful comment about Chevron at a retired teachers board, I said to them, I said, we don't need their money. We need gas masks for our students, teachers, and the community. Thank you for being here.
I'm hearing a whole lot of great programs, things that we want to do in Vallejo. I'm wondering how important was it in the beginning to have that one symbolic thing out there that you mobilize people, like Chevron. We don't have a Chevron exactly. Now, we have a cement plant that we need to march against, but we don't have a Chevron that we can get people pretty much to agree we need to do something, and there's money involved that we can then, if we win, you know, count on. We have Lennar that we're not happy with out there, but not everybody, you know, agrees on what to do. We have Hallahan, who's not creating anything creative around our water, you know, and we have definitely an old boy network that controls a lot of everything behind the scenes, but it's invisible kind of. So we don't have a Chevron that can bring people together, because there's always disagreement over what to do with the police or what to do with the schools. Or, you know, what can we use as that mobilizing huge that gets a movement going?
Well, I'll start and then you can finish. I mean, one of the things that I heard, I know Rascal mentioned, I mean, there's an issue. Our issue, you know, we mobilized around the casino, so it wasn't just Chevron. You know, I think it was that 2010 election? So, you know, we knew that people didn't want this casino. And so that really mobilized folks. And it was easy to say, if you don't want a casino, vote for these folks. And that made it easy. So, what is it in Vallejo? Is it the, you know, medicinal, the dispensaries? I don't know, the cement plant, you know, what is it that would bring folks out, you know, to say, you know, that mobilizes across gender and race and ethnicity? What is that one issue? And only, you know, you guys know what that is. But so in Richmond, that's, you know, that was one of the things that one year.
Right. I was going to say that similarly, that Chevron kind of became more and more the issue. When I first ran back in 2004, Chevron was an issue, of course, but it was they hadn't felt the threat that a progressive alliance was there yet. You know, I won, and then I was the only RPAer on the council at the time. And then they saw things that I stood for, and then they got concerned, and they started throwing lots of money to oppose me and, you know, Jovanka and other RPA candidates as they came along. Having a big refinery can be an organizing kind of, you know, center for people to organize around, but I don't think it's necessary. I think that I undoubtedly have lots of advocacy groups. You have the cement plant that I hear is getting a lot of momentum in the community to stop. You have other issues. Each of you may be involved in one or another advocacy group. And the thing that people have to understand, and you can do this, you can educate people, is that, you know, you can either, you know, go up in front of the city council time and time again and say, oh, I hope you'll do this, I urge you to do this, you know, if you only, you know, here is what I stand for and I hope you'll give this consideration. But if you don't have the people on that city council pushing the buttons, it's like you're wasting your breath, you know? So you gotta educate people. So yeah, you have one issue here and one issue there, and maybe it's not, you know, the big elephant like we have Chevron in the middle, but just reaching out to each other and saying, we've gotta come together to get those people on your board, on your council, so each of our separate issues can be voted affirmative, you know, the way we want it to be voted on. So, yeah.
I realize this is not exactly the forum, and I would love to sit down and maybe get a list from you, because for me the issue, we have a lot of people here who are super smart, super dedicated, and we all come out. But we aren't organized in terms of having an umbrella organization, so that's pretty interesting. But I have to tell you, Richmond does have a lot of money. We don't. So I think you guys get $13 million a year from Chevron, for instance, to help you with your budget. So you actually have staff on in the city that has time to write grants. We don't. We have had so many opportunities. I've been involved in the basically safety issues since we lost 47% of our police in 2008 due to their own issues. Thank you. But we don't have the staff to write grants, and that's what I heard you say. And grant writing, as you know, is a very specialized talent, and it costs a lot of money to hire grant writers. So I guess I would like you to talk to us as the very baseline, grassroots, smart, tired, overworked group that we are, and tell us what a good first, second, and third step is. And can I, by the way, after this is all over, get your phone numbers?
Sure. I hear you. I hear you. I just want to say, in 2004, when the RPA first ran candidates, we formed in November of 2003 specifically to run candidates, and then the $35 million deficit hit in 2004, in early 2004, which is another rallying point that can bring people together. But we had massive layoffs in the city, you know, police, fire, SEIU 1021 had, you know, over 100 layoffs. So there were, the city now, by the way, is just barely making it. But you're right that, you know, Vallejo has went through a bankruptcy. So you have some special challenges there that you're coming back from. But what I'm trying to say is, when we started, we were in the hole, you know, and with layoffs. And it, I would say a first step, you got to identify people who are willing to take a step forward, to say, I will run for city council with, you know, with your support. You know, nobody can, if you could run a slate, that is the way to do it. Run a slate of, you know, if you have three openings or four openings, run those people. Make it a diverse slate if you can. Bring it, you know, bring the progressive voice front and center in the city. Make it heard, you know, and say, you know, you want to build the city up. You want to make it clear that Vallejo can do it. You know, you don't need to bring in a cement plant to do it. You want to keep the health of the people front and center. And, you know, little by little, it took us, like I said, a decade to get to the point that we're at and that we have a progressive, well, close to a progressive majority. We have some that are a couple people that are tottering, yeah. But, you know, it takes time, it takes effort. And, yeah, I mean, I understand the issue about not having staff to write grants. If you could get the city to at least contract or hire one person to be a grant writer, it would help a lot, yeah.
So my question is, when the Chevron candidates ran, I doubt they ran saying, we're going to give Chevron everything they want. What was their BS campaign theme, and what were they saying they could do that you wouldn't do? And my second question is, other than the $144 million, which is substantial, what have you guys done to make Chevron more accountable and more environmentally conscious and hire more locally and basically make it to where they have to do their good citizenship?
Well, I'll start and then pass it to Jovanka. Chevron is a big, big issue, of course. So their candidates, Chevron's candidates, you know, bought up the PAC that Chevron started and, you know, was the large donor for, bought every billboard in town and put up all their candidates on the billboards and attacked us, you know, with their billboard campaigns and their constant mailers to people's homes. People got sick of it, you know. So what did they say? They didn't say much, you know. They would criticize us, say, you know, we're Chevron bashers, you know, and we would say, no, it's Chevron that's bashing our community, you know, with their pollution, et cetera. So, you know, they would criticize us as saying we're anti-business when we come back and say, no, that's not true. We stand for small and mid-sized businesses, and Chevron, we just want you to be, you know, a good neighbor. We don't, you know, we know you're here to stay. You know, I mean, we want you to switch to renewables at some point, but we know you're here in our community. We just want you to be accountable to the people. In terms of what we've done, we got we approved a Chevron project. They called it the Modernization Project. We called it, it's more of a retooling project so they could refine heavier or higher sulfur crude. And we got some really strong conditions on it. Some of us wanted even stronger conditions, but we did pretty darn good. We brought the whole community together. We have someone here from our Sunshine Alliance. Janet, why don't you raise your hand? Who also worked hard on our campaigns as a key lead organizer. We are holding them accountable in terms of air emissions. We go to the air district. The Sunshine Alliance is very much on board with that and in the forefront to make sure that we get reduction of emissions. We made sure those conditions in the project stood for that. One of the conditions is that they have to hire more of our residents and they have to train them. So we have made those gains. We got a $90 million community benefit agreement out of approving this project with its, you know, conditions and such. So we think we're it's a better it's a it's going to things are going to be Our environment is going to be a little bit better, still not where it should be. We get money for our community, and it's going to be safer. There's more safety impacts. We've done a lot of protests. We were suing Chevron because of the 2012 fire. So these are some of the things that and we want to make sure that we get what the community deserves in terms of this, any kind of money that comes from the settlement.
You know, when you asked what did they run on, lies. You know, basically they lied about everything that we did. You know, in other words, they said that they did what we were the ones who did. But keeping people informed throughout the election, like with this special newspaper, the Richmond Sun, we were able to put out the truth about them as well as ourselves. And so, you know, this person is saying, you know, they did X, Y, and Z, and we're saying, well, that's not true. Look at how they voted. You know, look at what they've done before they even got on the council. So those are the kind of things that help. But I also am reminded, since I'm seeing Bernie buttons, yeah. It's like that. It, you know, Bernie is saying, is the only one that's saying anything of substance, that's saying anything that we really care about, right? And so that, I think that's what was going on in Richmond. So when we had candidates forums, we were talking about the minimum wage. We were talking about, you know, helping people stay in their homes. You know, we were talking about, you know, the need for a hospital. So, you know, the things that really resonates with people on a daily basis, you know, having food and you know, employment and being able to pay for things because, the you know, you're getting a living wage. Those were the things that people were like, okay, all right. And they weren't saying any of that, because they didn't believe in it. And so having candidates that are saying the things that, because they're on the ground, that you know people want, that really made a difference. Because they're, you know, the other side, they're gonna lie, you know. And then, I mean, even now, you know, you see these debates. Well, afterwards, right. But I felt like I needed some kind of a, you know, right, relaxant. But I watched that Republican debate. It's so nauseating, right? And I did it just to kind of see what they were talking. And now, as we see what's going on, they're saying, oh, this stuff that Bernie's saying is really, like, the people are really liking that. They're digging that. Let's start talking about that. So they started talking about that. But people, I think, it's because people are waking up, they're beginning to see, like, they're lying. They don't even care about that stuff. But they see that the general population, the people, the masses care about it. And so now they're trying to talk about it. So talk about, you know, what you know to be true and real and needs of the community.
Right. What Jovanka was saying about how they took credit for what we did was just an outrage. I mean, we renovated the parks. We, you know, worked to address the need for, you know, violence reduction. We did all of this, and they put up these big billboards, Richmond, City of Parks, big Chevron emblem. Like they brought it about. You know, they resisted. You know, they basically their candidates resisted it. They instead wanted to, I don't know what they wanted to do, but yeah, you know, we have too many. Remember, right. We saved the shoreline, you know, our 32 miles of shoreline, and they put Richmond, you know, city of 32 miles of shoreline, you know, big Chevron emblem, you know. So it's like, it was really kind of outrageous, but that's what you get. The more you advance, the more they come back at you, and we all have to know that. That's why when you guys organize, it helps us as well. And, you know, hopefully our organizing and our efforts give, you know, some momentum to you all and help you, and we want other cities to do the same. So, you know, it's hard to get it going, but it can be done. It really can, and it needs to be done, as you know.
You know, When you and Juan and I guess the other, there were maybe four or five people at the table at the very beginning of the birth of the RPA. There were only like four or five people, very, very committed people though, and from that, you know, a movement grew.
Hi, good evening. I just want to say in advance, if I get off topic, it's a Monday, I'm a mom, my brain is scattered, and it's a whole bunch to remember. So if I forget, please remind me to ask you, as a mayor of the city, what you did. So I just wanted to remind us in Vallejo that we didn't have a major organization helping, but we did defeat the LNG plant that tried to come here. And we did not have all that money to do that. And how they did it was, I guess, most of the folks that lived on the Sandy Beach front organized and people came together. It was a common cause and around health as well. And they were able to do it without the big dollars. Vallejo is also in a unique situation that Richmond isn't in, unfortunately. When it comes to grants, we're overlooked. Sacramento side gets it. Bay Area gets it. Vallejo in the middle, we have to fight hard. It was back in 2000, 2001, we were appealing to get youth grants here, training grants here, couldn't get nothing. Oh, Solano County, we don't do that. So we're in a position that you guys aren't, where you get available funds. I think the lady talked about that. We don't get that. And then when we do get it, somehow it goes to groups that are on the front line claiming they're doing the work, and they're not, and it funds their staff, and we're left out. So I just wanted to put that out there. I wanted to ask you, when you were mayor, what did you do working with the school district? Because we have a major health issue here. Our kids are literally in a war zone going to school. You have the mayor who says, well, that's really not my job. I can't tell the superintendent what to do. And then the superintendent says, well, it's unique in that we, you know, the schools are not, I guess, beholden to the city. We, you know, do basically what we want to do. We need to figure out as citizens, how do we force the city and the school district to come together and put in some real policies that are going to protect our kids at school?
Absolutely. Yes, absolutely. I mean, the school district and the city go hand in hand in so many ways. You know, people move to cities because they have good schools and such. One thing that we did was, and we do, is to do joint meetings with the school board and the city council, and that's...
Yeah, right.
And I know that...
Wait, should I say stand up, folks, who's been in... No.
That's not going to happen? Or I know Ruskell was trying to advocate for that. Well, and out of that, we come up with ideas. We have the city pays partially, and the school district pays partially for school resource officers to keep our schools safe.
While you're on that, how many do you know, and what was the amount that you paid?
I don't know. It might be something like six or something, two to each of the high schools. I forget. Yeah. One of the things, pardon?
They're very pricey,
yeah, of course.
Well, we know that.
You're paying for a police officer, and so it's the school and the school district and the city kind of shares the expense. One thing we also did, it's not so much that we were flush in money because of Chevron. We did get that $114 million that was front-loaded more. Now it's dwindling down, even though it's over 15 years. But in the for 2010 through 13, it was pretty significant. We, in order to keep some of our schools open, three of our schools open, we gave the school district $3 million. But in return, sort of a quid pro quo, there's a Richmond swimming pool, the Kennedy Swim Center, that's attached to the high school, and so the school district, but the city owns it, and so the school district paid for the roof, the new roof that's needed. So there's been some joint projects. We're working on a project at Nystrom School. It's called the NERV Project, the Nystrom Urban Revitalization Project, something like that. And there's a school. We're going to build a community center.
There's a maritime center. It's a historic building that was renovated. And there's going to be some new affordable housing. And this is something that we've worked with the school district on because we'll share some of the facilities like the community center and such. So it does take that getting together, you know, as elected officials.
Okay, so if they don't come together, because we've kind of done some of all of the above.
Really?
Yeah, and I heard her say it's very expensive, but on the tail end, it's even more expensive when you're paying out litigation for kids who's been murdered and attacked.
Absolutely.
Do we spend it on the front end and prevent lives from being taken or harmed, or do we, you know, wait until it happens? But when you don't have that cooperation, how did you as a mayor force the issue? That's what I'm asking, because there's a lot of us in here who's been pounding them, and they seem to think they can do what they want to do. Does it simply come down to voting them out of office?
I think so. I really think you have to do that. Yeah. Yeah. Because you could go up, you could urge, you could beg, but we weren't able to see the change until we had progressive voices sitting at that dais. We still need the community out in the, you know, we work together, we govern together, you know, with a community movement and people who stand with the community on the dais. But we were facing the same thing, you know, going up there saying, you know, what we say, and then going home and they're passing what they pass.
Right. And this is my last comment, which I'm well aware of what Richmond went through, because you guys had CBE, and I know they're still around in West County Toxics, and supposedly they were your allies, but behind closed doors, they're cutting deals and signing deals where their organization gets money and the community's left out. That those days are over, because we've got Black Lives Matter, we've got other organizations with the youngsters who have come up and start saying, hey, wait a minute, we've been duped, so we want to get involved and make change. But we just got to keep bringing it back to, how do we force these people to do what they're doing while they're in office? We're going to vote them out, obviously, until then, we need to seriously find a way immediately to make them do what we need them
to
do.
In the meantime, before you get to the point where you vote them out, but then you also want to be, you know, setting up people you can vote in, because that's going to be important. But you keep saying it. You go to their meetings and you keep saying it, and you keep saying it, and you keep saying it. It really does boil down to, and you just get rid of them and you put people who are there, because, you know, it's going to take, it also takes, you know, some creativity. Because one of the things that I do love about my city and very proud is that people, you know, people are innovative. And so, you know, if the city council, if school district doesn't want to do something, then, you know, how can you organize and create something? So, you know, with the ceasefire, you know, you have the faith community who are walking, you know, well, maybe you have a group of folks who are retired or whatever who walk with the kids. I mean, you know, it's getting creative while they're still there, if they're not listening. And then you get to the point where you get them out. So as you're speaking, and you know that, okay, who can we replace these people with? Then those people need to be at those council meetings every meeting, because my wife and I moved to Richmond in 2005, and I was approached and I was asked to run in 2007. The election wasn't until 2008, and one of the plan was, you got to be at the city council are they televised here in Vallejo? Right. So, you know, that person, those people, they're at the meeting talking about the issues that you want us, that's dear to you. Because the people that are watching on TV are saying, oh, I like that person. Because they're going to see you all the time. They're going to see you every week or however often you guys meet. And they're going to be hearing you saying the things that they want to see change. Yeah, that's right. The schools are you're dangerous. So if you decide to run, they're going, I'm voting for her. I remember she was talking all that stuff.
That's right. We're working on her.
All right.
Short. Nah. Little.
Yeah. Yeah. That's right.
I'm so glad you guys came here, so thank you. And I'm glad to see so many people from the community. I will say that I met Mr. Fettig tonight, and he's the head, I guess, of the Vlamorine Terminal. Is that correct to say? Project manager. Okay. So some of us have a variety of interests here. The thing I wanted to ask you guys about is, in Vallejo, we have, I would say, a high degree of voter apathy. We may actually have registered voters, but they often don't vote. And combined with the voter apathy, I would say, is maybe voter... ignorance is the word that comes to mind. Maybe disinformation. A lot of people who, they get that pile of mailers, yes, and then that's... What they vote on, and who's producing the mailers? Well, it's the side with the money. Mm-hmm. So I'm wondering, you have now, a 12-year history of building an alliance. Has your voter registration and or participation increased? And if so, how were there things that you did to make that happen? Because those of us that try to do voter outreach, we just run into a wall. And I can tell you from precinct walking, we get like a Swiss cheese map, you know, of a neighborhood, and it's like real spotty in terms of registered voters and voters who've registered voters who've actually gone to the polls.
Do you have an answer yet?
So we do bring registration forms with us going precinct walking. And, you know, we do registration drives periodically. I don't know if we've actually gotten the voter reg rolls up all that much. I think we should. There are folks that work, like ACE works on voter registration quite a bit, and they go to door to door, and they are, you know, we'll have a seat at our, hopefully at our RPA steering committee table soon. So we want to do that more and more. In terms of how to get people out of their apathy, I'm going back in my mind to when we started the RPA, and I remember, you know, sometimes people just want to put forward the, you know, what we will do and how we'll change things, but you got to focus on the bad stuff too. And you have to, I remember one of our first flyers that had like a flame on it, like Richmond is burning, you know, Richmond is, you know, ready to implode on itself, it's falling apart. You know, you have to get people to realize how urgent it is. You know, we are, and it's true of our society in general, we are in urgent, critical times. And you have to break through that, you know, hey, it's going to be okay, or if I just take care of myself, or if I, you know, I don't want to, you know, ruffle any feathers or make any waves. You got to break through it. So you got to say, you know, Vallejo's in trouble, you know, and, you know, our city council is not, you know, the majority on that city council is not helping us overcome this trouble. Here is our vision for a better Vallejo. You know, we will stand with the people and, you know, et cetera, for this and that. But you have to kind of, it's not an alarmist thing. It's a reality thing. You have to say, you have to let people know. Our kids deserve, you know, a planet to live on. Our kids deserve a city that offers them community centers and programs and jobs and, you know, and fun, you know, and education and safety. So I think you have to, I forgot exactly what, I just remember a little flame there. It was something like, we're in trouble, $35 million out the window. And so you got to wake them up if you can. And yeah, keep putting those voter registration forms in their hand and say, please, I'll wait for you if you fill it out, you know, so.
So I just wanted to say that Vallejo is not lacking any old-time social justice advocates. We have more than enough social justice advocates in this town, let me tell you. And we also have some folks who know about community engagement, community building. And, you know, I mean, I believe, and I know that there are lots of us in this room who believe that the inherent wisdom to solve any community's problems lies within the people who live in that city. So
We out here in Vallejo, we know how to solve our problems. Some of us may be a little reluctant, and one of the things that you mentioned that was not mentioned is that we can recall folks too, you know? People, they're not necessarily lifetime jobs, okay? Okay? So that is an option as a taxpayer and as a voter. But the other thing that I wanted to say is I really wish that people would look at www.voicesofvallejo. Just read the website. It is really about everything that our guests have been talking about. It's about pulling together a coalition of social justice advocates, progressives, and working together to solve some of the many problems that we have in the city. We can do it. You know, I mean, I'm really happy that they came to talk to us tonight, but I don't think that we really found out anything that we didn't already know in this room. And let me just say that we do have somebody who writes proposals for the city. His name is Dan Armenta. Is Dan still around? Yeah, and Dan's one of the best in the country. I worked with him when I was in private.
And we just got a $2.5 million grant from Attorney General Loretta Lynch to hire 5 new police officers.
Oh, great. Whoa. So Dan's really good. So we have that kind of resource in the city. Well, you know, the thing that we don't have, and then I will definitely get off my soapbox, y'all. But I really would like for us to start to trust each other and come together, you know, and know that the only way we're going to solve the city, the problems in the city, is if we sit down and come up with our own solutions. Richmond had their solutions. Vallejo has to come up with our own solutions, okay? Vallejo strong, y'all. Vallejo strong.
Hello. I just want to make a quick question and hopefully going back to the basics on this. I don't want to run out of time, and I really want your insight as the time you were a mayor. How can we shake the city council people ground so they will work for the community? Something that you were afraid of. Tell us one
How
or two things that we can do.
How can you shake the city council what?
Ground, so they will
oh,
not
shake
be-
shake the ground.
Right.
Yeah, shake
so
them up.
They will
up.
Not be comfortable.
Yeah, yeah. So I think I think what the previous speaker said is true. Every locale has its own dynamics that has to be put into play, you know, to make change. Richmond had its own, Vallejo has its own. I think what you need to do, what we did, was to be at the city council week after week after week, speaking to the issues, making them feel the ground shake underneath them. Hey, we are watching you. Not only are we watching you, but we're running candidates to take your seat away from you. And we may even do a recall to take your seat because you are not serving us. I remember in 2004, Myrtle Braxton used to come to the podium and say, "Who made you the king and queen of Richmond?" You know, because they were so upset with the way people were running the city and laying off people and closing community centers. So I think, you know, you have to keep the pressure up there the whole time that, you know, the old council is in there. And then start, you know, reaching out to come together as groups, hold a progressive, meeting, you know, and invite various groups to the table and have a few coffee and donuts and start talking about what we need to do. Who's going to identify a candidate? Who will run? Who will talk to, you know, somebody that they know who might run? Begin that process so that you can then have those candidates go every night of the council meeting to speak out and have their face get known and have people help them, you know, with whatever need, their speeches, make sure they address all the various issues. Speak at two or three items a night, you know. Be known, be at the community events. To me, you know, the pressure from the community and the pressure from the candidates are what's going to make them know that, hey, a new political culture is happening. So.
Okay. Two quick questions. One is about environmental protection. I'm sure the refinery has a lot of things happen, and how did you guys protect or monitor the thing which is happening in your neighborhood? Because we don't believe the city or the agency take an active role in protecting the citizen. So how did you guys do that? That's the first question. The second question is about, like, we have like housing project in our city, and very often, I mean, there is a lot of times there are crime, criminal activity associated with that, and how, I don't know if that's the same experience in Richmond, and how did you handle that type of, because we have a very strong or big, large Vallejo Housing Authority, and from citizens' point of view, it sounds like they are more interested in bringing more subsidized housing, which we don't have problem, but if they bring it in, somehow some people has to make sure there's no criminal activity associated with it. So these are the two questions. One is about environmental protection, and the second one is about how do we balancing the affordable housing and the criminal activity.
So I'll just touch on both of them. Maybe Jovanka, you could elaborate. The issue with air monitoring, for example, we want to make sure that Chevron has air monitors in the community for the pollutants that come into the air. So that was something that we made sure that they had to put into play as a result of projects that they got approved. So, you know, it's still a scary thing. You know, every Wednesday the siren goes off as a test, the test siren, and you know, it is a reminder to us that, you know, this refinery, it's inherently dangerous. But we continue to push them to do more, and the monitor it was more the safety issue that you were saying, what are we doing? Well, we're causing them, by way of this project, again, we had to make sure that various safety issues were addressed. We want to make sure that they replace the pipes, like the one pipe exploded for the 2012 fire. So because of the project, they're required to replace a lot of the pipes, but not all of them. So we're putting pressure on the Air District, and through the lawsuit, we're suing Chevron. We will want this lawsuit to make sure that further safety protections are in place. So that's just a quick thumbnail of some of the things we're doing.
Go ahead. Ask more questions.
Sure.
Yeah, so for example, like we have a company in Mare Island, which is like they call it Mid Mare Island Dry Dock. And recently they have been sandblasting their ship. So actually we see cloud of dust coming from the Mare Island to here. And also, they are doing this project 24 hours a day. So it's like the noise which interfere with people's sleep. And also, when we think about this, how do we know they are not polluting the water or the land there? So it sounds like it's such a big thing, and nobody is basically taking care of it. It's even after the citizen reported this problem, is like there's no action. So I just kind of, yes, air quality, for example, you say, okay, we ask them to do monitoring, but there are so many other areas.
There really are. Like we have Petcoke in Richmond, and there's trains with Petcoke that isn't covered. And I know in Benicia, they have issues with coal coming in. In Oakland, they have issues. And I mean, we're part of this refinery corridor, and I think Vallejo's issues with the environment are part of this whole issue, because you know you're in that same region, and obviously you have issues that are very harmful to the community and to health. You know, asthma rates, etc. I know this big cement plant is a big concern. So, you know, so we used to have asthma clubs in our school, and so we raised that issue. We want chess clubs, not asthma clubs. You know, so you got to raise the voice and make it clear. And those are ways to do it. It's a community effort, and get those people on board. On the other issue of the affordable or the housing. Our housing authority projects also had problems with safety. We had, and we have some contractors, security guards there. It's HUD does not provide enough money for cities, unfortunately. And so HUD was telling us we needed to not hire these contractors so we could balance our budget more. And we said, no, we want our residents to be safe. So, you know, you have to, we're working things out with HUD now, but yes, you got to make sure that you do what's right and putting the people first and push those, you know, national agencies to hear us on the ground, what our real issues are, because sometimes they're so high up, they don't get it.
Good evening. I want to thank you for coming. Really appreciate you taking the time to come and give us information tonight. I just want to say real quick before I answer my question, I retired after working over a decade in City of Richmond. So I've watched City of Richmond do their emergence, and we used to, and I'm sure you hear, and I say it in all due respect, you're like, oh, you better watch out because you might turn out like Richmond. And now it's, we need to be more like Richmond. So I want to just give you kudos for that. And because I worked in the city, we were close to the refineries, and due to the spills and the fires that happened, we developed a shelter-in-place program where we had the nightmare of one day maybe we may be stuck in this building in a room with a bunch of people that we don't want to spend the night with, but we couldn't, you can't leave because we didn't know what the air quality is. So that thought just really bothers me here in Vallejo, that we would have something similar to that happening here. But when you were doing the fight with Chevron through the grassroots level, I know a lot of the reports in the publications that you guys put out had a lot of medical and environmental data and statistics in it. So how did you get that information? Were you able to get the county to work with you through the grassroots level, or did you have to do that research on your own?
A lot of it is public information, and yeah, it's a matter of you know. Luckily for us, we have I'm thinking about a couple media like the Richmond Confidential, which are students. You know, they did a lot of investigative stuff, and you know, so you know, we got some of the information from that. But a lot of it really is public.
So the county agencies didn't assist.
It's the thing is, if it's public information, they have to give it to you if you ask for it.
But they didn't take any lead role in advocating
for.
They don't
play a role. They don't. The Richmond Progressive Alliance is an independent organization. We seek out information from the county, and we work like Communities for a Better Environment will seek out, and they'll do their research. We work with the Haas Institute in Berkeley that seeks out information, but we are independent, so they're not gonna. They know that we're political, and so the county isn't gonna just kind of side with us, you know, though we wish they would. So. But that information is there, yeah, that's right.
Hi, thank you again for coming, and I have learned a lot of things, so I'm really glad you're here. But my biggest question, or my most important question, is how did you get your group of candidates together all on one plane, in agreement to, as a block, go for it? Unfortunately, in Vallejo, we have a history of, I know that everyone in this room is heading for the same good of Vallejo, but we've got all this little crummy, stupid history, and then we've got personal things. And so I could right now name you four people that we could get the majority, and I so agree with you because I've been in front of the city council and I might as well be talking to the air about anything I want done unless we have the majority. So how did you get this group, this block of candidates to say, we're going to go for it?
Well, we don't always agree on everything.
Well, I know you don't.
But we do agree on the big things, well, you know, like we know that for the RPA only endorses candidates who will take no corporate donations. They also have to have good progressive values and, you know, and other things. But if you say, well, you know, I might take a little money from this corporation or that corporation, I can't sign that pledge. Well, then the RPA, so we're already on the same page in terms of wanting a people's movement versus having, you know, the corporate domination or the special interest. You know, we support unions. We have that same mindset. We support, you know, community policing. It's, you know, we kind of, as active, we support helping the homeless. We support sustainability and overcoming climate, you know, climate change and all that. So, but we sometimes disagree, and the RPA will have disagreements, and that's okay, because you come up with sometimes new and better solutions
compromise.
As a result.
Compromise.
Right. Well, sometimes it's compromise, sometimes it's something completely new. But Jovanka came up with the idea to call ourselves Team Richmond, you know, so me and her and Eduardo were Team Richmond, and she said, hey, why don't we call ourselves Team Richmond? You know, I was like, I don't know, Team Richmond, you know, are you sure that's good? And she said, yeah, it's going to work because, you know, they're going to put out Team Chevron, so let's do Team Richmond. So we did. And I think, you know, we worked through the disagreements, but on the big things, we agree.
Thank you.
That's right. I mean, that's really what's important. And I think that's really the beauty of it is that we are all different.
Right.
You know, we all have different perspective on things, but what we agree on is
big picture.
Is the big picture, exactly.
Thank you.
And it really does, and that people like to see that. They don't want to see, you know, a group of folks that are all alike, even though that's what they tried to paint us. The Chevron candidates, oh, they're all going to think alike, they act alike. No, we're all different.
Oh, you're all very different.
You know, I don't think Gail likes hip hop. I love hip hop. Yeah, right? Probably right?
Yeah.
Right. But, you know, I just say that, just, you know, that's just like something I say that, you know, lightheartedly and, you know, because we're so different, you know, but we agree that government should be of, for, and by the people.
Thank you.
Hi. Thank you for being here. This is very interesting. I've only been in Vallejo for a year and a half, and what I'm sensing is a vibrancy beginning to occur here, and having you guys here is, I think, emblematic of that. My question really has to do with your organization. If I heard you right, it's a 501c3 now. It's no, okay.
It's up until recently, it was just a grassroots organization. We now have. Although our numbers grew, you know, and we had a steering committee and such, but now we have nonprofit status, but not a 501c3. We're an unincorporated nonprofit, is what it's called. Yeah.
Okay. But it is an official organization.
It is.
As members?
Yes, we have membership. Membership dues are $12 a year. We're electing a new steering committee. We just elected new bylaws, put into place new bylaws. And had a full house for that. So we're going to have action. We do have already action teams. We'll have more action teams set up. So yeah, we have been evolving over the 10 years, 12 years we've been in existence, and we're at the point now that, like I said, we're going to, or not only are we an alliance of individuals, we always were an alliance of individuals with from varying political affiliations. You know, it's nonpartisan races in city elections, so we don't worry about, like, I'm a Green, Jovanka's a Democrat, you know, a progressive Democrat, and so we don't worry so much about that. What we worry about is that we share our values, and I forgot where I was going with that.
How many members do you have?
I don't know. We have many, many people. Janet, do you know how many members we have? You're not in the membership committee. 400 or 500, but our e-newsletter is about, you know, reaches thousands. So we have a lot of people that are on the periphery, but 400 or 500 members now that are actively starting to pay more and more attention and formal participation in our process. Yeah.
So it's a relatively small group of people. Small group of people.
And well,
400 or 500
out of 108,000.
Like,
yeah, yeah, yeah. Janet, go ahead. Yeah, but 400 or 500 are kind of are active enough to pay their dues, and, you know, and identify as part of the RPA. So, you know, but Janet is right. You know, sometimes we have 100. Right after the election, we had more people, a couple hundred, you know, out in the room, you know, and showcasing their support. So, but we're growing, you know, always evolving and growing.
And you have regular meetings.
Yeah. Yeah.
Develop a plan, like a plan of action for the year for the alliance and some
priorities?
Fashion?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah. And then it's pretty. I was about to say though that, you know, it started off with like 5 people and it's grown, and with that evolution came even more organization, you know. So in other words, you know, I'm sure like initially it wasn't, we weren't that organized, but we were organized enough to know we need to have, you know, elected officials on there, and we're going to organize enough to get them elected, and we're going to organize enough to maintain, to keep the platform going. And so now, you know, as we've got 3 elected officials on there, now it's about getting like really organized. And so, I mean, I say that to say that like it's not something that has to be scary to do. You know, you can just have a handful of really dedicated people and grow from there.
Gotcha.
And it did, you know, we started out in Juan's living room, and there was about 8 or 9 of us at the beginning, but each of us were involved in other things, so we really represented more than that. So it was just a question of coming together. So I know each of you, you know, if you came together, you would say, oh, you know, when you have your discussions about forming an alliance, well, yeah, I know there's so many other people that are engaged in wanting to see change. So even though it was small at the beginning, you know, we had our tentacles out there, and we made it a point to reach out further. You know, anything happening in the city, on our email list, we were like, hey, there's this meeting happening, or there's a rent control group that's forming. There's a North Richmond Shoreline group that's trying to save the shoreline. Be at that meeting, you know. So we were there, and so we you know, started out small, but we had our tentacles out, and now our actual membership is growing, and we expect it to even grow further. But it does take diligence and hard work. Yeah.
Do you meet monthly?
We meet monthly as a steering committee, and I believe our bylaws, our new bylaws, are now saying that we will meet quarterly as the full membership. So steering committee monthly, and the whole membership quarterly. And we have a office and all that. At first we didn't have an office, you know, but we would find places to meet at. And like I said, originally in someone's living room, later it became some places that the union let us use, but now we pay rent, and that becomes another issue. You know, the membership dues help us pay, but some people give more donations than that. So, yeah.
So the budget is, you have some budget to work with.
Right, we have some budget. We have a treasurer, yeah.
Mm-hmm. Good, thank you.
Mm-hmm. Hello, everyone. I'm very happy that you guys are here tonight. I've learned a lot, and I'm even more happy that your last couple sentences brought me right in transition to ask you a question, and that would be that the unions historically have been very helpful in helping with progressive causes. And I see that in your presentation you said that SEIU was also very helpful. But in Vallejo, there seems to be a different dynamic. And I've worked with unions all over the Bay Area, and it's, for the most part, it's always been very progressive. They're always helping what like-minded people in the room have been for. But it seems like the Building Trades Council in Vallejo has completely a different outlook. And so my question is, what other unions did you get involved with? And I have a follow-up question for or comment how I think what could be helpful.
Yeah, I'll start here. Well, the building trades, you know, in Contra Costa County, they sound similar. I have a union person that said, you know, the building trades will build a crack house if you give them enough money. Yeah. And that's unfortunate, right? Because that pretty much sums it up. And it's so unfortunate because that's not what they should be about. But you know, SEIU and the California Nurses Association, CNAs, who else? ASME 57. Who the
CTA,
the teachers union, which there was who was it, the California CTA, did you say that? Yeah,
Richmond.
That's right. Mm-hmm. Yeah, the Richmond teachers RTA, Richmond RTU, Richard. Yeah, so the teachers union were also involved. Who else can I think of? The communication workers are also involved. Yeah, they actually were supportive of us. Yeah, but unfortunately, the building trades. You know, it's so unfortunate because when they see us fighting for better wages, for just safety at the refinery, you'd think that they would join the cause, but they still didn't, they still don't, and that's unfortunate. But yeah, I think, you know, definitely getting the unions involved, sitting down at the table with them, talking with them to understand what are their priorities, and are those priorities in line with yours? And I think that they would join forces, because that really helped us. You know, I think SEIU, I think they have something in what we have, like 900 members or so in the city, or is it just, we have 900, a little less than that. But that's significant, because, you know, if their membership, the membership and the leadership is progressive, and they're saying these are the folks that are going to help you in your situation, then they're likely to be on board with the support.
All right. Well, thank you. I guess to my point is, unions are like little democracies as well, and you know, we can reach out to different parts of the building trades union and to their actual members, and you know, get them to change their leaders, and get them to actually, you know, engage. I know that, you know, I hear some laughter in the background. That's great, but you know, if you don't try, you don't get it done, you know. And you know, we can do it, but we have to get other people involved. And all these people here are very active, and I'm a newbie to politics in this, but I do try to follow as much as I can. but I want to say something else. To me, it sounds like even though, I mean, you can see, I have a Bernie hat.
I love your
hat.
I love your Bernie hat.
And I love a lot of the things he stands for. And a lot of things he stands for is strong union work. He's like for the postal workers and, you know, et cetera, et cetera. But I think, from my perspective, I think the narrative has to change. And like for like you guys having Team Richmond, right? And the people that we don't mostly agree with here in Vallejo, it jumpstart Vallejo, right? And then they use the other term as a drifts of term for describing us. Whereas like, you know, if we come out with like health, safety, and prosperity, you know, that I think those are the way to go. And because that's all something that we can agree upon. And I think we could have a bigger tent and we could beat these guys. So thank you.
I just have a little aside to help you guys feel good about this. I lived and worked in Indonesia for 8 years, pretty much through the 1990s. Unical was there, Caltex was there, they eventually all have become Chevron, and they are just as disgusting and horrible around the world as they are right here. So good for you for trying to fight them, that's all.
Well, thank you, and I'm back again. I wanted to mention that I grew up in the Richmond part of El Sobrante and graduated from De Anza High School and lived in the Iron Triangle for 10 years. So I'm quite familiar with Richmond, and actually I love Richmond. However, I now live in Vallejo. Now, my last comment is would you connect your movement with the progressive movement in the 1900s and the fight against the oligarchs?
Okay. Yeah, I connected with the fight against the oligarchs of any era. I think we are part of a progressive tradition in our country, whether it was the fight, the suffragettes, whether it was the civil rights movement, whether it was the women's movement of the 70s, whether it was the environmental movement that still goes on, whether it was the union movement. You know, it always takes a few people. It always takes people looking outside of the status quo to make change, and you know, movements of people in the streets, you know. So our model in the RPA is different and is something new, because we have people in the streets and people sitting on the dais in those seats, and we think that is a recipe for success. And we think of cities all over, and many, many people are reaching out to us and wanting to hear about, you know, how we did what we did, because we were one of the few success stories in the 2014 elections when all kinds of conservatives won all over the country. And, you know, here we were fighting against $3 million and we won. So we do think that it's something that we need to have happening all over, because, you know, Richmond is not an island. None of us is an island. So, yeah, I would say that our efforts are such that we just want to keep them going, and we encourage everyone to keep working. I think I covered the question. I don't know. Yeah.
So we're going to wrap up now. We'll give you a chance to talk a little bit. If you want to talk to Gail or Jovanka, feel free. We have to be out of the room at 9 o'clock, and we're going to have to break down all the equipment and chairs. So thank you for coming out. Thank you very much. Thank you to our two speakers so much for being here.